Namo founding teacher Shakyamuni Buddha. Namo founding teacher Shakyamuni Buddha. Namo founding teacher Shakyamuni Buddha. The unsurpassed, deep, profound, subtle, and wonderful Dharma is difficult to encounter in hundreds of millions of kalpas. Now I have the chance to see, to listen, receive, and uphold the Dharma. May I contemplate the true meaning of the Thus Come One. One who can be called Buddha is one with perfect clarity, perfect understanding of everything that happened or will happen in the past, present, and future, and they understand it accurately. Being well-rounded, there is no lacking in their knowledge. It's correct, without bias, hence we call it perfect clarity. Buddha's wisdom included perfect clarity on the infinitudes of the universe, how it came into being, the origins or lack thereof, the processes that took place, and the fate of the universe at the end of the cycle. None of this he did not know. He knew everything about this 3,000 years ago. Buddha already envisioned, talked about the universe, how many layers of it and how many multitudes of it, long before the scientific advancement in cosmological studies. Back then, he already knew of the Milky Way, the solar system in the Milky Way, and that it goes to the infinite. Buddha knew everything down to the very detail of all living beings in the universe. The fact that he could say that 3,000 years ago, without any scientific tools like telescopes, proves his supreme wisdom. He knew how the universe evolved and the processes of the universe's life cycle, described as formation, existence, deterioration, and void. Only people with supreme wisdom are able to do that. Normal people cannot do that. 2,500 years ago, Buddha said in the Infinite Life Sutra that in our current era, the food will no longer be safe. He said that the food will be filled with poisons, be harmful to our health, and all the soil will be infertile. That is, it will be hard to grow healthy food. He talked about this obviously extending to polluted air, polluted land, and polluted sound. All of this is mentioned in the sutras that were recorded 3,000 years ago. From this hard evidence, we can see that without supreme wisdom, a person without full wisdom, a full picture of the whole thing, could not even fathom this kind of thing, let alone say it out loud in a very consistent, structured manner. The point of saying this is to complete our life. The first thing is a happy life, but it goes beyond just having a happy life. It's also a full understanding of the whole cause and effect, the whole cycle, the elements that cause this to happen, and what the result of it is. So this is the greatness of the Buddha. This is where the Buddha's greatness lies. He did not have any bias, error, or delusions. Only a person who has attained this level of understanding and knowing can be called a Buddha. There are many wise people, but if you put the wisdom to the highest standards, to the strictest standards of no bias, no error, and no delusions, only then can one be called a Buddha. This is something like what other religions call their deities or deity, God, as all-knowing, omniscient. But this is actually inherent in all of us, not just deities. Everyone has this ability. That means we all have the right and potential to reach that level of being all-knowing and omniscient. This is just a brief overview of Buddha and his wisdom. We will now go into depth on why we can't reach that level. Before we go on, I would like to clarify one thing. Now we are talking about the truth of the universe. We are talking about the truth. Before I came here, I was giving Dharma talks at universities. I always had a lot of students from different religions or traditions say to me, our religion tells us the creation of the world, no matter if it's sentient or non-sentient, is all created by God. They then ask me, what did the Buddha create? What can Buddha create? If one day you have friends, colleagues, or people asking you this kind of question, what can Buddha create because our God can create everything? Could you answer that kind of question? Because in this world there are people who might try to find comfort in showing off, maybe because of the lack of exposure to other traditions, that they're thinking in a very narrow way. It happens and it will happen. But back to the point, talking about the word truth. Buddha, 3,000 years ago, already talked about it. Buddha cannot create the truth, only discover it. Just like scientists, they don't create gravity, they can only discover gravity. These things are already there. If you call it truth, it should have already been there. It is just that we are not aware of it. Creation is a common conception in Christian or Abrahamic religions. They are at this level of understanding. When they talk about truth, they always refer to creation by God. Every human, every animal, every rock, they call it Genesis. Everything is created by God. But in Buddhist teachings, we do not say creation, because the truth of the existence of the universe is already there. You don't create the truth. If it's created, then it's no longer the truth. The problem is the person who observes it. It's not the truth itself. It is that the person who observed the truth is not fully aware of its presence. The universe has always been like that, has always been working in this way, and we are just not aware of it due to our lack of wisdom. We have all lived in it for many lives, but we are not aware of it. In the Mahayana Sutras, Buddha stated this many times. Buddha was awakened to these realities due to his supreme wisdom and told us exactly what he observed. Understanding this level of knowing is what we call ontology. Hence, the truth cannot be monopolized by any masters or gurus. It cannot be monopolized by authorities, whether it be religious authorities or secular authorities. Nor is it debatable or refutable. It's like the question of the chicken or the egg. Does the egg come first, or does the chicken come first? There is also a question of whether Buddha came before the Dharma or the Sangha, because Buddha talked about Dharma and formed the Sangha. But without the Dharma, how could there be Buddha? Without the Sangha, how could there be Buddha? All of these are correct. There is no one fixed way. Buddha has told us about life, that it consists of birth, aging, sickness, and death. No one can change that fact. Even nowadays, this is the truth. Everyone will be born, age, get ill, and die. These things still happen today, right? Buddha has taught us that life in this world consists mostly of suffering, very few pleasures, and very little happiness. If we talk about the ratio, look at us in 365 days. Which portion is more, suffering or happiness? This goes on for as long as we are here. There's no need to think about who created the universe or us. The point is this thing is already ongoing. We need to be aware of it, and how do we get out of it? A lot of people say God created the world. Some very common things people also ask is, if God can create the world, why can't he create something that makes us all equal, where everyone has the same access to resources? Why are there bad people? Why are there murderers? Why are there bad guys? It just does not work like that. It's pointless to argue like this. What Buddha taught us was how to look at the truth that you are facing right now, and how do we solve the problem at hand. That's more important than the chicken or the egg debate, or if the glass is half full or half empty. The point is, more importantly, can you find the meaning of your life in this lifetime? Can you find your purpose, your mission in this lifetime? That's more important than anything. The point of practicing, learning from Buddha, being a student of Buddha, is to become awakened, to become wise. That means to return back to your full, perfect clarity, to recover your wisdom. So let's continue. Buddha told us that all beings, including ourselves, have this supreme wisdom and such enormous capability. We have the capability of knowing the past, present, and future, knowing the cause and effect, and knowing the formation of the universe. Let's look at Amitabha Buddha. He has been the Buddha for 10 long kalpas, a very long time. Buddha created a world called the Pure Land with the capability of lifting ordinary people to the level of a bodhisattva. You too have the same ability as Amitabha Buddha to do that. If we talk about potential, even now, right here in Australia, as you sit here, you can become a Buddha as well, at this very instant. Why Buddha mentions this is to remind us that we all already have this ability. Don't need to seek or gain anything. We just need to recover it. In the sutras, Buddha said, all beings are equal to the Buddha in every aspect, without any difference at all. He didn't say that I am Buddha, you must be lower than me. No. He said all beings are equal to the Buddha in every way. You and Shakyamuni Buddha are the same. You and Amitabha Buddha are the same. You are Amitabha Buddha. While practicing the thrice yearning ceremony, there is a phrase we say, Amitabha's heart is my heart. My heart is Amitabha's heart. However, so what's the however? What's the but? However, when we look at the reality, our current reality, why is it so different? Didn't Buddha say we are all equal? We are supposed to have well-rounded wisdom and good fortune. Why are we so far behind Buddha? Let's look at some examples close to us. In this society, there are smart people, and there are ignorant people. Do you want to be ignorant or do you want to be smart? We all have a preference in our heart. No one wants to be ignorant. Everyone wants to be smart and intelligent, right? Also, there are people with strong capability and also some people who are incapable. Also, some people are born into a wealthy family, while some people are born impoverished. These are some of the very real inequalities that happen in our world. Some people, once they are born, can immediately enjoy the luxuries of life akin to an emperor, Some people are born into poverty, they are sick, and their life is hard. For example, some people who are born in Australia have everything prepared for them. Everything is good. While some people are born into an impoverished or war-torn country. Some people, if they want something, they just need to utter it and they get it. Some people, no matter how hard they work, can't reach that level. Some people are born tall with good-looking features, while some people are not. What is the cause of these differences? How did these differences come about? Why is this gap so big? A lot of times, children might even begrudge others and whine to their parents. Look at the neighbor kids. They have better toys. They have nicer clothes compared to me. This is quite common to compare ourselves to others, thus this inequality. Also, some people have been in business for 10 or 20 years. They work so hard, but they still can't get financial security. Some people are born into wealth. What they want to have, they can have immediately. They can just spend millions of millions with no problem. How did these differences come about? Why do the conditions of all sentient beings vary so greatly from one another? Buddha told us why there are these differences is because we are lost. We temporarily lose our wisdom. Our good fortune and our wisdom is originally well-rounded. It's perfect. However, we lost it. We lost sight of it. So today's second part of this talk, we will talk about this loss. What does Buddha mean by lost? Lost what? How did we lose it? In Buddhism, this is a very key word. In Chinese, it's called me. Because of this word me, or lost, we are living a hard life, mentally as well as physically. So Buddha talked about lost in this context. Lost refers to our delusions in the form of wandering thoughts, discriminations, and attachments. Because of these delusions, wandering thoughts, discriminations, and attachments, we commit negative karmas every day, repeating our faults, unwholesome actions, unwholesome speech, and unwholesome thoughts. Do we have these kinds of issues? Let's think about it in the most honest way, especially unwholesome thoughts, speech, and actions. How many of these deeds that harm other people do we do in one day alone? Mostly to the people who are closest to us. For example, thoughts of hatred, lust, or greed lead us to all of the unwholesome actions that, as we see nowadays, harms the earth and pollutes the world. From this example, something very close to us that we can see every day is why Buddha kept saying that we need to put a stop to our unwholesome deeds, our wrong actions. We call it repent, or more like reflect and repent. Without reflecting on our faults and correcting them, we can't improve and we can't return back to the wisdom that we lost. Another example is the deeds that you do that are not good, not beneficial to others. The effects of these actions will harm you in the long run. For instance, when you make a sneering remark, it might hurt other people, and in the future, some people might do the same back to you in a different form. The reason why we all have an infinite level or amount of karma is because of these three delusions. We do something wrong, we say something wrong, we think something wrong. So the current homework is to break through the cause of our sufferings and miseries. If we do not change ourselves, reform ourselves from the base level, from the deepest level in our heart, then we can't improve our life. You can't get good fortune or well-rounded fortune. I believe everyone feels that in their life, something is missing, something is lacking, something needs to be done, improved. It's a very honest observation. If you think that your life is good and well-rounded, why would you want to come here and listen to this Dharma talk, chant Amitabha, or want to go to the Pure Land, the land of ultimate bliss? Because you want to get out of this misery. If there's no misery, why would you want to go seek rebirth in the land of ultimate bliss? If you are enjoying your life right now, if everything is 100% good for you right now, you would not want to learn Buddhism. But it's not, right? Because of these delusions, our lives become miserable. For example, my Dharma center has a young person who just started a relationship. He talked to me about the afflictions in his relationship. He said, I thought when I started this relationship, we were looking for happiness in each other. However, the result is the opposite. The deeper we went into the relationship, the more pain we felt. We are supposed to be happy. Why is it so sad and miserable? When you look at someone who just got married, or maybe after 1 week, or 1 month, or 2 months, they get divorced. Why? Because if we just rely on the emotion we call love alone, it has been polluted with lust, with control over others, owning others, these kinds of thoughts. It's all based on the ego, me, me, me. If that other half of you, that partner, does not fulfill that vision, that desire that you have set in your heart, then you feel pain and hence afflictions arise. However, if you look at bodhisattvas and buddhas, those sages love, we call it compassion. We don't call it love. Their compassion, their love is real because they have no self-interest in it. Even when you say something harmful, hurtful to them, or even inflict harm on them, they will not retaliate. They will not have hatred. This worldly love, if it can't, if it doesn't satisfy each other's needs in the relationship in any form, be it monetary loss or anything, becomes hate. Love becomes hate. Buddhas, bodhisattvas, and all the sages, their love is like a parent's love towards their children, unconditional. Respectful Dharma brothers and sisters, this is the very key point you need to be awakened to, be aware of. Why do we learn Buddhism? Because if we practice it, we become wiser and wiser in handling people, in handling our emotions when facing people, when facing all sorts of conditions. No matter if it's a good or favorable condition, or a bad, miserable encounter, our hearts will not be moved. Our minds will remain still. That is the goal. However, the reality right now is that we all get swayed by anything that happens around us, and the worst part is that you get deeper and deeper into this love and hate, downward spiral. That's the cost of our downfall. That's the cost of losing our full wisdom, our full fortune. What should we do now? How do I go back? Buddha told us, you have an innate wisdom, one that is perfect and well-rounded, but unfortunately, you lost it. From the level of Shakyamuni Buddha, Amitabha Buddha, from the level of a Buddha, that means a person who lives freely because they are wise and they don't get entangled. Not becoming someone we are like today, an ordinary being with a lot of entanglements. Let me ask you a question. Are you actually an ordinary being in essence? No. No one is always an ordinary being. It's temporary. It may be quite a long time, but it's a temporary condition. It's a temporary disease. You are a Buddha. That is who you are. That's your original identity, but you lost sight of it. Because you lost sight of it is why your capability and wisdom fell from the level of Buddhas to today's level, an ordinary being bound by all things. For example, someone who is drunk. When they are drunk, they lose their rational thoughts. They act irrationally. But can we dictate that this person in that drunken state is him or her in essence? No. When they wake up, they come back to their original self, their normal self. It is the same for us. Getting back to the topic of lost, we are lost because of the delusion of wandering thoughts, discriminations, and attachments. If we break through these three layers of obstacles and get back to our home, back to our enlightenment, back to our Buddha self, then we become Buddha. That means we are free. We are truly free. This is real freedom. The key is to let go. To let go of our attachment to everything. Yes, it is a sound path to walk, but it's so hard to do. I chant Amitabha every day, or I meditate every day, or whatever homework I do, but I still have a lot of afflictions. I chant Amitabha, I pray to Buddha, I read the sutras, I listen to the Dharma, but yet my afflictions remain heavy, my delusion remains deep. What can I do? In fact, the benefit is subtle. What is the benefit when you listen to sutras, or Master Ching Kung's speeches, or this Dharma speech right now? You were reminded, you were washed once again. Someone like Buddha, his word is born out of one with a pure heart, pure wisdom, is at a level to wake you up. We just need to be immersed more in there. Next Wednesday, I will continue this topic with you guys. Today, being together with everyone here, first we learned the core goal of learning Buddhism is to learn about ourselves. To learn more about ourselves, to know more about ourselves. We also learned why you should learn Buddhism in this environment, what Buddhism can bring to the table to help me get through this life. Then we talked about being lost and how we can find our way back, the cause of the loss and how we can find it back. Also methods we can use to break through the delusions, the wandering thoughts, the discriminations and attachments which caused us to do bad deeds, to have bad speech and bad thoughts. How we can transform it and turn it around. Next week we will talk more in depth on the topic of how we find our way back. Now it's quite late. It's 9:30. We use this 1 hour to give a brief talk about how we recognize Buddhism, what the meaning of the word Buddha, and why we do not translate the word Buddha. Most importantly, how we get our Buddha nature back. That's what we learned today. Hopefully next Wednesday from 8:30 to 9:30, we can gather again to continue these topics. If today I've mentioned anything that is not right or wholesome, I hope everyone can give me some feedback. I also hope next Wednesday we can all participate and learn together. Because of your participation, it encourages me to settle down and learn about myself. Learn about Buddhism, which is about myself. Then we will all be able to improve together. That's the biggest benefit of coming together and learning. I hope next week we can learn together and also encourage our dear youth group and also myself, because of you, we will have this condition to be together. It is very rare to have the opportunity to study with you guys and to review and understand this together. I hope next week you open up your camera. Don't hide behind the screen. Open it up so we can see each other. Don't hide behind the camera and leave me alone here drifting. Open up your camera next time. It's also a sign of respect towards who's ever speaking, towards a monk. If you keep your camera closed, it feels like there is a gap between us. We cannot connect. Back to this topic, it gets more and more interesting in the upcoming talks. It gets better, actually, especially with all of these great masters, including our teacher, Master Ching Kung, giving very interesting content. I can't repeat everything, but I can go over the main points with you. Okay, that's it for today. I hope everyone has a good, healthy life. All right, see you again next Wednesday. Amitofo. Verse of Repentance. All evil actions committed by me since time immemorial, stemming from greed, anger, and ignorance, arising from body, speech, and mind, I deeply repent having committed. Dedication. May the merits and virtues accrued from this work adorn the Buddha's Pure Land, repay the four kindnesses above, and relieve the sufferings of those in the three paths below. May those who see or hear of this bring forth the heart of understanding and compassion, and at the end of this life, be born together in the land of ultimate bliss.
谢谢大家，阿弥陀佛。晚安，晚安，晚安哈，阿弥陀佛。
大众请起立。下个星期三见哈，见哈。下个星期三，阿弥陀佛。
阿弥陀佛。阿弥陀佛。